Hi guys, and welcome back to another IbraCorp video. Thanks for coming back and tuning in with us today. In today's video, we're going to be overviewing 6.9 version of Unraid, which is now the stable release, as well as 6.9.1 update, which just happened to come out last week. So if you're running Unraid and you want to know what's in the new version, whether you should upgrade, and what's involved to upgrade, let's do it together, and I'll show you how to run through it. Just before we get into today's video, guys, I want to say a big, big thank you to everyone who's helped support this channel. From the people who are subscribing, liking our videos, those who are subscribing on our website to get the videos first, thank you very much. Especially those who are helping us financially and supporting with a pledge. We really appreciate your support. It's been absolutely amazing. And you know what? We're not that shy of 1,000 subscribers, so I'm going to pretty much consider this our 1K sub video. So a massive, massive thank you again. I really appreciate everything you guys have done. If you have any questions, you're always welcome to ask me or anyone else on our Discord. The link's always in the descriptions. And we've had a few members join up in the past few weeks, and they've been really helping answer some of the questions people have. Obviously, I'm only one person, so I can't really get to everyone, but I do my best, and other members jumping in has really been immensely helpful. So thank you to everyone that's been helping in the Discord. I really appreciate you guys. If you're not a subscriber yet, please consider subscribing. It really helps the channel out. We also take requests, any ideas you might have, throw them in the comments. I'll add them to the list, and I'll see if I can get around to them. Okay guys, so let's get into the new 6.9 update to Unraid. As you may or may not know, Unraid is not often pushed into a major update. And that's one of the great features of Unraid, and why people love it so much is because it's relatively stable. It's one of the most stable operating systems you can definitely find out there. And they do this for a reason. I mean, you put a lot of work and a lot of effort into building your server. There's nothing worse than doing an update and then finding that maybe 1 to 10 things have broken. And the reason why scaling these updates out so long is a benefit is because it gives you time to read up and understand what the changes are going to be and whether they affect you, so you can prepare ahead of time. So I'm here on their website, unraid.net. This is the official website. I'll put the links down in the description. And what you're looking at is the details for the 6.9 update. So this is the big update. Anytime an update goes from, you know, 6.8 to 6.9, that is a major release update. So we're looking at a huge update here, guys. And this was on March 1st, 2021. So not that long ago, you know, less than 2 weeks ago now. And we'll just scroll down and I'll walk you through what some of the things are. And then we'll actually go and perform the upgrade on our server. So if you already know all this stuff, you want to skip to that part, feel free to do that. So let's scroll down to the first thing they've listed here. So multiple pools. So this feature lets you define up to 35 named pools of up to 30 storage devices per pool. So if you're one of these guys with a huge amount of hard disks, this will also benefit you here. They're created and managed by the main tab. So the benefit of having multiple pools, as you can imagine, is that you can separate the pools out so that certain hard disks are storing certain data. Now, previously that limit was a lot less. Having this feature now to define up to 35 named pools and up to 30 storage devices per pool. So you could have a lot of hard disk. Now, I'm not sure about you guys, but if you've got a data center in your house, your missus or your boyfriend or whoever it is might be a little bit concerned about you going a little bit over the top. Well, as a home labber, that's just part of the territory. So us home labbers, we look at this and we think, well, that's a lot of disks we can chuck in a pool now. So that's awesome. So we'll just read on. When you create a user share or edit an existing user share, you can specify which pool should be associated with that share, which gives you really fine-grained control. The assign pool functions identically to current cache pool operation. Also a really useful part here when you're talking about the mover. So here we've got more balance options for the format of BTRFS. which means that you can have three copies of data on separate devices. Now that gives you just a lot more redundancy. If you have four or more devices in a pool, you now rebalance to C4, which is times four copies of data on separate devices. So that allows us a lot more redundancy with our setup. And obviously in a RAID setup, and a RAID array, the whole point is that we can rebuild a disk that's failed using data that's stored on other disks. This one's a big one for people. Previously, you know, getting your GPU to work, it was possible, and there was definitely instructions on how to do so. But now it's looking like more of an integrated feature, which is really fantastic and helps a lot of people who want to run a graphics card for the purposes of, for example, transcoding for Plex, and have it all sort of integrated within the OS itself without needing extra amounts of plugins and workarounds. So as you can see, it now includes selected in-tree GPU drivers. You've got this one, you've got your Intel, AMD, and Radeon. Scrolling down a little further, it'll explain the NVIDIA drivers. So one of the most popular third-party drivers requested, which it has been for a long time, is an NVIDIA GPU Linux driver. The driver is required for transcoding capability in Docker containers, i.e. Plex, or Jellyfin for that matter. Passing parameters to modules. The use of con files, or configuration files, in config mod probe may be used to specify options and pass arguments to modules. So that gives us more fine-grained control on what our network data is doing, and you can assign it to a specific network interface to be the primary, whereas before it was basically selecting a master and a slave and alternating between the two. As long as they were bonded, it just saw them as, you know, one, so to speak. But now you can fine-grain that a little bit more. In Docker, several upgrades to Docker management, and you'll see this when we upgrade our test server, and I'll show you a couple of things they've changed there, but let me just walk you through this. Now possible to select different icons for multiple containers of the same type. We've also made some changes to add flexibility in assigning storage for the Docker engine. First, RC Docker will detect the file system type of lib/docker, which is where your Docker image is stored. We now support either BTRFS or XFS, and the Docker storage driver is set appropriately. So that's all sort of automated now, which is awesome. Mount_image is modified to support a loopback file formatted either with BTRFS or XFS. Also, the ability to bind mount a directory instead of using a loopback has been added. So really nice to see a lot of changes with Docker there, and there's definitely more here as well. Virtualization. Now, if you were passing through PCI devices into your virtual machine, you would have known how sometimes it was a bit hit and miss. Now, this makes it a lot easier because you can control it before it boots and have that control when you want to activate them and deactivate them. These changes were integrated into the system devices page thanks to Skytales and LJM42. And there's a guide here on the topic, so you can follow that if you like, or give them props there. So make sure you follow that guide if you're interested. Another huge one, multi-language support. Huge amount of languages have now been added, which is awesome. Having those other options there really opens up Unraid to a bigger community. And that's what we want to see, right? We're here to help support the community. We want to get the community going, spread the word of Unraid. Honestly, if you're an Unraid user, if you were to think of Unraid as a religion, I'm telling you, there's some fanatic people out there, me included. And there's a whole bunch of other stuff here, guys. The Linux kernel, the base packages, you know, better handling of your smart devices, your SSDs, SSH improvements, heaps more. They've done a lot. So a really big pat on the back to the team over at Unraid for their hard work on this and all the community developers that have pitched in. Now, we're just about to install and upgrade our operating system. I will show you one last thing, which is the latest update, 6.9.1. And we'll just have a quick breeze through there. There's not too much to go through, but I thought since it's the latest release for this video, I might as well cover it real quick. So notable bug fixes: fixed an issue where code outside of the Unraid management utility calling smartctl would set up conditions where devices would never spin down. Right? Note, you still need the plugin to support SAS devices spinning down. For Docker, if an in-tree GPU is loaded which result in creating a dev/dry device nodes. We set permissions for these to 0777 to ease integration. Piping exit on a terminal window will now close. Pretty useful. We added a nocache header to NoVNC web access so that future Unraid releases will no longer have stale web components. Awesome. OpenSSL for security updates. The Linux kernel has been updated to 5.10.21 and a patch 5.10 LTS, which is awesome. Included kernel config settings necessary to include certain hardware monitoring devices and added support for new devices. So that's really fantastic. Now, there's a couple of updates there for your GPU driver as well. Please install each 777's NVIDIA driver plugin. Make sure that you're using that. So if you're using an NVIDIA graphics card in your server, make sure you get the plugin. Make sure that you're using it. Get the full benefit of your card. Okay, so we've yapped on, I think, long enough. Let's log into our server Pumba and we'll go from there. So we've logged in. You can see that our server is on 6.8.3. So it's pretty out of date now, actually. So in your Docker tab, just click stop all. As you can see, we already stopped. And in VMs, just make sure you stop all as well. With that done, head over to Tools and Update OS. So we'll click Check for Updates. And you can see here, it's going to tell you straight away, 6.9.1 is the latest. If you weren't sure, check your branch. By default, you should be on Stable. If not, you might be on Next. Now, it's really up to you guys. Obviously, Stable means that it's been more thoroughly tested and less reports of issues. So I would always recommend going for a stable option. If you're an advanced user and you want to try, a beta or dev version, feel free to go with Next. But we're going to go with stable here. If you click the little eye, it'll give you all the release notes. Now, this is a lot more than what, I just went through before. And that's the reason why I'm not going to sit there and go all day, because you could really just take all day to read all this. But a huge amount of updates. It's really amazing. Okay, it's really, really cool. So let's leave it at that and click update. You will note it says, please reboot your server. Okay, really important. So we're going to go ahead and reboot the server now. Yeah, go back to dashboard. Oh, and you can see it's given us the banner, which will make it a bit quicker for you. But if you didn't get that, you can just do it here. This will shut down. And if you just hover, this will reboot. Either. So let's reboot and wait for that server to come back up. Okay, so our server's restarted and we're now back on the login screen. Not too much looks different here, so we'll just log in. And we're signed in, so welcome to 6.9.1. Now, having a brief look here, the first page we're on is the main page. Nothing looks too different. Let's head to our Docker tab. And there's a couple of changes here. So for one, you used to be able to just click and drag these to move them in their priority. That's changed now, so there's a little arrow on the side here that you use to drag them up and down. And look, to be honest, between me and you guys, I actually liked it better as it was before, but that's just how it's been done now. It's not the end of the world, but probably stops you accidentally doing it, which has happened before. Next thing is you'll find logs have moved. So logs used to be over here on the right-hand side. Now they're under the menu, so you click it and click logs. That's where you can find your logs for your Docker containers. If you are not familiar or you're not experienced with this, your logs are so important. They are absolutely critical. So make sure that you are checking this stuff often, especially when you're having problems with your Docker containers. The logs will tell you nearly everything. The other thing I'll quickly show you, if we go to the App Store, as we see as an update, quickly update that. There's actually a new thing here, Unraid.net, and that's coming from the official Unraid repository. So it's an official plugin. If we click to install it, you'll see it installs it straight away. So now that that's done, we'll click done and we'll go to the settings. Now the first thing you'll notice up in the top right corner, installing the plugin has changed what our appearance looks like in the banner. Gives you the name of the server, the description, and an option to sign in. Now this is your Unraid.net account that it'll ask you to sign into. So if you don't have one, it'll ask you to create one. If you already have one, you can just simply sign in. So I'll do that now. So I've signed in successfully. Now safely close the window, and we'll close that. It's completely optional. You don't have to use this plugin, but it's just an extra feature that's just come out and it's still in beta. So I thought I'd show you what you got, show you guys what it looks like. Because it also allows you to back up your flash. So if we click activate here, we've now activated it. Now if we click update, it's now up to date. So this backs up your flash data in case something gets lost. You can then copy that back in. Now some people may have already been using the backup plugins inside of Unraid. And if you're like me, you're probably backing up stuff to the Unraid server itself. Whereas this feature will back it up to your account so that you can then bring it down again at a later point in time. The other feature it allows you to have is remote access. Now, by default, it will not allow you to activate it unless you've got a SSL certificate and the TLS options to auto. Okay guys, so we're gonna have a quick look at provisioning an SSL certificate as well. This will allow us to look at our remote access dashboard. So first come into here and go to settings. It'll take you to your management access. Underneath is your unraid.net, which we set up earlier. As you can see, allow remote access is still disabled, and because it wants us to provision an SSL certificate. So just here, you can click provision. As you can see guys, we've clicked provision, it's now given us an SSL certificate. And we'll click OK, and it'll reload the page. Now that that's done, try signing in. And we're now signed in. And if you see in the top corner there in the lock icon, you can see we now have a valid certificate. Let's try going back to our settings. And we can now see allow remote access is available as an option. So we can then go click yes. What port do you want it to be on? And check the port, make sure that works. Server is not reachable, and that's because I am not allowing the port through the router at this point in time. So if you are going to do this, make sure that your port is accessible. At the moment, Nginx Proxy Manager is running 80 and 443. So I'd have to probably set something up to forward that across. Now, essentially, you could have remote access available anytime, and it's associated with your account. So just make sure that you check that. Having a certificate's there, it is optional but highly recommended, and it just pulls it down from Let's Encrypt. And when the time comes, you'll be able to renew it as well. Up in the top right, you can go to your server's dashboard as well, shortcuts to your forums and Discord. Now, the dashboard, I believe, is meant to show you your server and show you access to certain things, whether the server's online, any storage that's available, how much is being used. At the moment, I don't know if it's working or if it's just down for myself. I'm just going to leave it for now, but I'm hoping that's working by the time you watch this. Now there should be pretty much nothing stopping you from now using your server. You've updated all the way up to 6.9.1. Everything is operational and we can see that everything is working. So your next test would most likely be starting up all your Docker containers and making sure that they all start successfully as well. There we go, all of our containers have started. We'll check the same with our virtual machine. Make sure that starts up too. That's pretty much it guys, that's upgrading your Unraid server and what the new 6.9.1 looks like. And if you have any questions, feel free to drop them down below or in our Discord. Please remember to like and subscribe, and we'll see you in the next IprCorp video.